Okay, we're taking on the last main lecture that has to do with the symmetry that applies to molecules. And I just want a quick review of what the Coriolis PQR structure is again. And then I'd like to look at the clusters that have to do with these local symmetries a little bit more. And then I'd like to take on something that's a current topic and one that can be argued and interesting because it can be argued, but also interesting because this clustering provides a new effect. And this will lead us to study some of the things that have to do with entanglement of spins and the orbital motions that we've been talking about. And then we'll drop to the very simplest example of this, which would be a diatomic, say, O2 molecule, or a linear molecule like CO2, or such a thing that has a basically a d infinity H symmetry. We need to look at that symmetry because that is very important for people to deal with these kinds of molecules. And of course, our atmosphere is mostly that. And then we'll take a little bit, something that's a little bit advanced. I'd like you to see how the Coriolis stuff that we talked about last time applies to this, the simplest, shall we say, simplest Lie a group. This is a Lie group, the whole infinity there makes it one. And then we'll talk about transitions, because the issue is, do transitions occur between these things we call rho vibronic spin symmetry species? We have to define those again with respect to that. Now, whenever you're dealing with marrying spins to orbital spin angular momentum to orbital angular momentum, the Pauli or Fermi-Dirac effect on fermions, or the Bose-Einstein symmetrization for the integral spin bosons comes up. And the most elegant way to handle that marriage between the two kinds of angular momentum is with the permutation group Sn and the Young tableau. So half of this lecture is going to be devoted to these magic boxes, in particular the hook length formulas that will give us the heights of some of the lines that we've been looking at in these clusters. Particularly simple will be the XY4 molecules like CF4 that we looked briefly at. But S6 presents a whole different concept about this connection between all of the spins and their various effects with respect to the rotation and vibration of molecules like SF6. So that's what's being discussed here, involving what I call super hyperfine spectra. And finally, we'll look at C60 at the very end if we have time, because there's a whole nother bunch of issues that come up with that haven't yet been seen, since people haven't been able to take high resolution spectra of C60. So let's get started here just with what we've kind of mentioned already, and that's the Hamiltonian of a molecule, which if you are familiar with all of the different things that can happen to molecules, this list of terms in the Hamiltonian goes on probably all the way down to the far wall. But we're going to just consider the ones that are appropriate to high symmetry molecules, like SF6, and that's the example I'll use. I'll use just two modes of SF6, both of them vector modes, because they're the ones that you can see most easily with lasers, and a scalar Coriolis interaction, as well as the tensor-centrifugal interaction we kind of sketched a little bit about yesterday. At this moment, at the opposite end of the room, is is a blow-up of what we'll be doing here, where you can see the fine structure levels for a spin Coriolis, I should say a vibronic Coriolis effect that we're about to talk about. So I'll point that out again when we get to that point here. Anyway, I want to just get this part out of the way, and then this will just be something we mention very briefly. So let's go ahead here and just take a look at what one of the modes looks like. This is called Nu 4. The Nu 4 vibrational frequency is about 600 wave numbers. That's the one that we have been blowing up in our pictures. There's a Nu 3 at 10 microns. It's faster and has, as we'll see, a very different shape to its elliptical orbits. But that's the first thing that you would really do with a molecule if you're going to be studying its rotational properties vis-a-vis vibrational spectra. What you're interested in is how much angular momentum do those orbits really contribute. That's the L that we're talking about here with this formula that has the total angular momentum be this vibrational L plus just the nuclear rotational momentum that's given the symbol N, or in some texts just R for rotor. Those are mostly my notation, but I'll use the more conventional one here. And what we want to do is use Rocca's little trick again. We mentioned that before. Let's look at it a little more closely to get the levels that you would have for a given Coriolis constant, this B zeta constant here, the zeta for the mode number 4, the lowest vector vibrational T1U mode. And then further up this scale, I'll show this is zeta equals 0. Further up, we'll have the B zeta sub 3, which is a different number. In any case, the way you get these levels and then study their behavior as you vary B zeta is to simply write the Coriolis thing as a total angular momentum dot the vibrational angular momentum there. So there's somewhere here's a J going around, and it's going to be dotted with an L vector that's more or less in one direction for each of the components of L, and L is a vector too. So you're looking at J squared minus N squared plus L squared in this 2J dot L. Okay, so that's pretty cool, the basic idea there of playing with the algebra is all you need to get a formula, and we'll be plotting that as a function of B zeta given the values of the just the BN times N plus 1, or R times R plus 1. Okay, so that's the idea here. And here you see what we did, is we said, okay, if J is L plus R, or L plus N, then R or N is just J minus L, and this guy right here, N squared is J squared minus 2 times J dot L plus L dot L, L squared, and that's what's giving us a nice way to get the eigenvalues for this operator right here. Okay, so these are the two modes. Now, they look a little bit different from what's in the textbook because I didn't bother to draw what they would look like if you put them in a rotating frame. But if you put them in the rotating frame, they polarize very differently. If you add up the ones that are going counterclockwise, the positive momentum, With the other ones that are going the other way, there's this one in here actually. Anyway, these are mostly right-handed. This is a right-handed thing, so it has a positive B zeta, which is, I'm sorry, let's see if that's right. Zeta 4 is that, it's negative. This one is actually positive.
That one switched, yeah.
If I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it switched with respect to the previous.
Switched, though, what?
It's switched with respect to the previous.
Oh, here we go. Here's the B zeta 3 is 0.69. This is minus 0.2, so switch the direction of the plot versus B zeta. So when you put those numbers in and then look at the two cases, here's the 10 micron vibration, and here's the 16 micron or 600 wave numbers. This is about 1,000 wave numbers, 1,000 inverse centimeters. That's where they sit for this particular molecule. And then you study the variation of this as you change B zeta. And that's what the charts down there are doing, but doing it with a fine structure. That's a real exercise in complex behavior. Anyway, this one, the 16 micron mode, is mostly left-handed. So that's what you're going to see when you have some rotation that polarizes it into an elliptical polarization state. That's for each of the things that are orbiting, they have different ellipses. Okay, so that's the deal. And then the actual spectra that comes from this thing, using the Rho-Vibronic two-dimensional spectroscopy, this is the ground state down here. And by the way, the splittings of the fine structure down in the ground state is very small, a few tens of hertz per J to the fourth. And J to the fourth is the centrifugal coefficient, so that's what makes it possible to see that splitting. But you can easily see the splitting due to B zeta. That's more significant. That shows up in the splittings of the P, Q, and R branches, mostly P and R, as we've seen in graphs like this, and I'll continue this thing. But all of the Qs are, for this model, on top of each other. Then the R, 0, 1, and so forth, 2, are located at places where they don't change the N value at all. And that's kind of a clue of what's coming later. There's a conservation, at least there's a tendency to conserve. If, in fact, I had used all of the intersections here, have a much more complicated spectrum than we actually observe. So this is the picture here. Now I'm going to get the other screen going so we can compare this with the actual spectra that comes a few pages later on this screen. So let me get this thing going here with the full view. And advance it through what we're looking at right here. And the screen is a little bit brighter, so it's the one which we'll use. In any case, this is what we're looking at. We're looking at this level of the thing where we can easily, with a spectra that can resolve, say, a hundredth of an inverse centimeter, that is, a fraction or a few gigahertz are easy to see on this, which is a Fourier transform spectrum. So this is a whole other technology. You have to go to a different building to get the rest of this stuff. And of course, this is a more common thing here. This is the old-fashioned infrared, very rough, they call it landscape spectrum. And we're just looking at one particular value of the angular momentum, you see. So we're up there looking at some thing. In this case, we're looking at the P branch, and we're looking down here, not one, not two, not three. That would be in this neighborhood right here. There's P, 20 right there, so P1 is in some sort of a mess right here. But we get out here to 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 88 angular momentum. That's a heck of a way along this trail this way. And then if you had a high resolution to look down here, you'd be seeing in the R for rays. Each of these represents a case where you raised the original angular momentum by 1. That's all you're allowed to do when you have a vector wave, which is a laser wave, hitting the molecule. Symmetry won't allow you to get much out of the others. And it also doesn't allow you to see these little R0, R pluses, Q minus, and so forth. Instead, you get something that looks very much like what you get just from a CO2 molecule or something really simple. So anyway, what I want to do is talk a little bit about what's behind the splittings of these. Now we know this one doesn't split, but the two, that splits like a tensor, and then up you go, so angular momentum 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 88, 182, 88, that's the splitting right there. That's the, if you could imagine Hans Bethe's surprise if he were to tell you we just did crystal field splitting for angular momentum 88. That's crazy. That's absolutely insane. But it's a different era than what he worked in. Okay, so that's the deal. And what we need to, of course, do is what we have been doing, and that is say once again that the tensor centrifugal operators, and it doesn't matter whether you're in the ground state or the excited state, they have the same shape. So the spectrum that you'll see in the ground state will have that shape to it, but a very small splitting. And in the excited state, due to that rotation, it's very much affected by centrifugal effects. Also described by a Fortran tensor, it has this shape. So you get to be able to describe both sides of this, and we'll show a diagram that has that later on, both the ground state and the excited states looked at from a distance. But in any case, what we are able to do is just simply find our eigenvalues by putting the angular momentum cone at wherever it intersects this energy surface. In other words, make something that is like a topography line. It's not an exactly a topography line if it's the cone, but a sphere that averages over each one of those is the value of the energy of the cluster. And of course, these clusters are as is seen when we expand each of those consisting of the symmetry species A1, A2, T1, T2, and E in various arrangements. So we've already talked about that sort of thing, and we've all, what I haven't spent any time on is just making sure you see how we get the rough, what we would call fine structure, and of course that's very fine compared to what we had before. In fact, before you couldn't even see the rotational lines. It's just a big spike and two lumps on either side. That was a big situation already in 1970, and we're very happy to have that. But the laser changed everything, so we could start looking at this stuff. Okay, so each one of these, just as this one bump here spans to one of those, and every one of them does a similar thing. Each one of these has these symmetry species that I just mentioned, A1, T1, E, T2, T1, E, T2, A2, T2, 1. Start over again. This is a series of four local symmetry clusters associated with something that's 0 mod 4, and then we're going down minus 1 mod 4, minus 2 mod 4, minus 3 mod 4. Here's the one that's at 84, that's clearly 0 mod 4, then that's minus 1 mod 4. This is plus 1 mod 4, plus 2 mod 4, plus 3 mod 4, plus 4 mod 4. There's the A1, T1, E again. So this periodic behavior is just reflecting the behavior of the local symmetry associated with the fourfold, and I'm going to go ahead here and put the correlation table, and then on this one, let's put the pictures of the RE surfaces responsible for getting us each of these clusters. And the coloring is just a mixture of colors that we have designated for the irreducible representations. In this case, or in that case, A1 is red, A2 is sort of an orange, E is green, T1 is a dark blue, and then T2 is a lighter blue. So we can see the different differences in colors here between the sort of the yellow that's a mixture of the fourfold clusters, I'm sorry, the 0 mod 4 clusters and the 2 mod 4 clusters, okay? So there's the induced representation of 0 mod 4 of the C4 to the octahedral symmetry that consists of 6 dimensions. And we'll look again closely at that particular one, but 6 dimensions corresponding to the 6 equivalent neighborhoods, local neighborhoods, on each of these mountains. So the mountain people live and make all of these spectral lines here, right up to what we call the separatrix. And this separatrix isn't too different in a character anyway from the separatrix that occurred on an asymmetric top. If you recall, going from the mountain to the valley, there are only 2 of each there, right? Well, this one has 6 mountains and 8 valleys. Okay, so the 8 valleys are corresponding to these induced representations here for C3. Okay, and the 0 mod 3, that's angular momentum z component. Now z is on the 1-1-1 direction, 84. Okay, and then as we go this way, we go 1 mod 3, 2 mod 3 for 85 and 86. And then once again, 87 is divisible by 3. We're back to this one again. So there's that giant cluster consisting of 1, 2, 3, 4 species, A1, A2, T1, T2, E gets left out. But that adds up in dimension, 1 plus 1 plus 3 plus 3 to 8. That's exactly the dimension of the valley count. There are 8 valleys. This is 8 faces of an octahedron, whereas here we're talking about the 6 faces of a cube. Okay? That'll make sense geometrically. You see, this is really a geometric problem all the way up through the analysis that we get for the induced representations, if you believe that group theory is grown-up geometry, which is not a bad definition of it. Okay. It's also grown-up number theory, because you're doing the modular numbers here, 4 and 3. Okay. What we're not seeing, and we looked at this very briefly, was what would happen if I made some valleys on the twofold axes, of which there are 12, these guys, this guy, this guy. Instead, we have a saddle point there, and nothing can rotate in a saddle point. That's hyperbolic motion. So that's similar to the asymmetric top in that respect. Okay, now let's see if there's anything else I need to say, but I think we can go on here, because what I'm really interested in, and this is stuff that hasn't been completely solved yet, we made a good try at it and we got some results that could be measured. When it comes down to asking, what do the 6 nuclear spins, this is SF6, fluorine 6. Now, the sulfur is at the center, so it's not really participating in any sort of hyperfine motion due to the magnetic field that's generated by the rotation of its molecule. But all of the fluorines are going for a ride here. They're out on the ends here, spinning around. At least four here are. And these guys are just sort of wobbling around on the axis. But then when you go to look at this one, they're all participating in that. So the question is, what was happening in nuclear spins? And can't avoid this question because, you see, in order to obey the Fermi rules, the Fermi-Dirac Pauli exclusion rules that go with fermions, I've got to make an anti-symmetric state out of the complete nuclei, complete set of nuclei, six nuclei here. I've got to find an arrangement of those six nuclei in a wave function that is described by a Young tableau that has six boxes. Okay, and then it has to be matched with another one that's conjugate pattern so that I get an anti-symmetric state out of the whole mess. So these are just pictures of what's got to be done using Young tableau notation to make the things, starting with the A1 orbit, which is totally symmetric. They're A1s every three times here, two A's there. There's an A1 here, and there's another A1 there, and then there's an A1 of each one of these guys coming out here. So that guy's going to be represented by, at least the spins are going to be represented by totally symmetric combination, which is what the horizontal axis of a Young tableau is supposed to indicate. And then that means it has to go with a totally anti-symmetric, which is the vertical box arrangement. So this is black magic, mathematical black magic that we're getting into here. Okay, but it's really powerful because this is something you don't need the tableau to do. I just take the symmetric thing and put it with the end, and I've got a totally anti-symmetric combination. But there's a whole bunch of other ways to make symmetry. This sort of weird dive. This is a symmetry of a fourth-rank tensor called the Ricci tensor. It's got that Riemann tensor. Okay, the fourth-rank tensor happens to have that symmetry. If I was just looking at four, I'm looking at six. I don't think of anything gravity uses exactly six. But anyway, these are taking care of all of the possible symmetry arrangements that you can do with an outer product of six wave functions. Next to six spin functions. So you take the flip of each one of these, and you can sum those guys up to make an anti-symmetric state. And that's the only anti-symmetric state for that particular avenue. So we're going to be looking at these magic boxes here and what they can do, even short of going into the details of the projection operators for these things. Just from the characters of the permutations, we're going to get a lot of information. And then something magic happens right around this neighborhood here, which is right about here, where the clustering gets too tight for us to have arrangements like that. And you have what's called spontaneous symmetry breaking. So we're going to talk about that now. And the question is, conservation or not explanation point of these A1s, A2s, T1, T2 symmetry species. And what role are they playing here? What are they doing? And how are they affecting the entanglement of the spin wave functions as well as the orbit wave functions? So let's take the Bibles of molecular physics, and these are three of them right here. The electronic spectra polyatomic, the infrared and Raman spectra. This is Gerald Hertzberg. One of the few molecular physicists to earn a Nobel Prize. Canada, National Research Council, mostly all his life worked at the Ottawa Research Center in middle of Ontario, Canada. So he's got a whole bunch of books, but I just picked these out and quoted something that he says over and over in his book. Books, anything has to do with molecules that brings up symmetry species. And he says, transitions between species is very strictly forbidden. And these are pages in which he says this several times in the neighborhood of those pages. And he says it's during transitions involving rotational states, vibrational states, electronic states, collisional states even, okay? And all the combinations of rotation, vibration, and electron, which came later, he says, your species never gonna change, okay? Now, what he was saying after that, very strictly forbidden, and I'll explain this in just a minute, but basically it's because the nuclear spin moments are so incredibly tiny, and they are, they're terribly tiny. And he might as well add to that, and they're going very slowly. The vibration is pretty slow compared to what you have in experiments that involve the electronic spin-orbit interaction. And a spin-orbit interaction involving an electron has a huge moment in the units they use. It's 2 gyromagnetic factor. Okay, here we're talking about a millionth in some of them. They're terribly small. So because of that terrible smallness, never going to happen. Forbidden. Red. Not going to happen. Okay. So strictly conserved, not conserved is what this guys start to say. And this was after I've been yelling about this for quite a few years. John Haugen was sort of the father of the American version of molecular physics. Wrote this little article on Science. And said the molecules with identical nuclei, blah 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 blah, might have a conversion, might be some conversion. So we're saying, Hertzberg's saying no way, we're saying way. There it's possible for conversion, transition, even perversion. Okay, so we're getting into quantum pornography here. Okay. On one hand, we have to conserve. On the other hand, we have to convert. Okay. Here's preserve or pervert. Okay. That's the argument. Are we going to do this or are we not? Okay. It's quite a thing here, arguing about which are you going to have conversion or perversion possible. And our claim, it's widespread and extreme mixing and even perversion of the species that occurs in these molecules. And I claim that's been observed. It's just that it's an indirect observation. So we have to argue about how do you get that. So the first question is, what preserves it? I mentioned that a little bit. But what mixes it up? And what is it? Okay? What's this entanglement stuff? That's what we're really, spin symmetry correlation has a new name. It's called entanglement, okay? And we'll just work with real simple things, like something that's got a symmetric orbit and an anti-metric spin, that's called a paraspecies. The reverse, where this is anti-symmetric and that's symmetric, that's called ortho. And I'll give some mnemonics to help you remember that. But what we have to do is what we did in the last lecture, kind of, and I didn't make a very big point of this, but this idea, Hertzberg's terms, overall symmetry, better, we're looking at the underall. This is happening under the underwear, okay? That's why it's perverse, okay? So, it's the internal symmetry, okay, that's going to pot here.
I have a question. How do you always fill the Young diagrams with the arrows when you want to specify
if you want to specify nuclei?
So when you fill them with the,
you fill them with quantum numbers.
When you fill them like with the arrows and all of that stuff, you're specifying symmetry.
You're moving way far away from Alfred Young's, the minister who was just working with permutations. You're moving way far away. What you're doing is you're looking at the symmetry of unitary tensors. Remember how we made the U2 representations? We made outer products, right? And it happened to be symmetric outer products because we used Boson operators and just endlessly tacked on more and more of the little spin of halves, right? Okay? Well, if you have spin up and down, you're really only able to make anti-symmetric and symmetric out of those spins, or those two spins. But you can do Young tableau that involve anything that has no more than two rows in the tableau. Because you can't anti-symmetrize triply with only two states. Remember, with anti-symmetry, every one of them has to be a different state, right? So if you only got two, that's as far as you can go. And that's what we'll be dealing when we have spin a half. But lots of molecules have nuclei with spin one, two, three, right? So we got to play the whole game here.
So you change your tableau shape.
So this is one more situation where we're branching off and not really distinguishing between a unitary group and permutation group. Permutation group is a symmetry of the unitary group, and vice versa. Okay, so this is one more of that situation of having a lab and a body. And we're talking about internal symmetry. What we want to do is we want to get down to the bare nuclei, bare rotor, okay? The activity that I'm going to use the letter B to describe. So this is one more case where we use the letters A, B, C. It's different from all of the other cases where we use the letters A, B, and C. And we'll get to that. Okay. A will be the activity. And then when you put the A and the B together, you make a constricted rotor, if it's a coupled rotor. That's C. Okay. So you get a quantum number that's a product of the pair with whatever activity you put on. If you don't put any activity on it, well, then you just use the pair symmetry to describe it.
I'm in the stuff, but I think Lewis may have, we need to go to the rest.
Oh, okay. Let's pause here. Well, we can discuss what we've got so far here. Yeah. Is there anything that you can think of that would be?
Is there a connection between, are we talking about global symmetry and local symmetry?
Absolutely. Yeah.
The overall, the underall thing?
No, and finally, when you get together and just say, all I've got in this universe is a bunch of particles and I've got some states for them to be in, right? The way you look at it is you say, okay, I'll think of the point of view of the particles, and somebody's going to shower me with a state, right? That's the sort of the global thing. You're labeling the particle when you consider it as a local symmetry. So that's one permutation group where you permute using the particle A goes to where particle B was and particle C and so on, or particle 1, 2. I prefer to use letters for the particles because we eventually obliterate and don't take respect of the particles. We think of what's the lab have to offer. And the states, you number those. Angular momentum 1, 0, minus 1, for example, or spin up, spin down, like that, you see. So there's a U2 tensor right there with all spins up. Okay, here's another one that's anti-symmetric and has one spin up. Better have one spin down, because if it's anti-symmetric, I can flip it and get a minus sign. But if I had another one here that was down, then when I flipped those two, I should get a minus sign, but I didn't do anything, you see. So something that, in the case of something that is both minus quantity and plus that quantity, the only thing that does that is zero. So the wave function doesn't exist. That's the Pauli exclusion principle, is no more than one particle can occupy every quantum state. Where you have labeled the quantum state completely, that means the orbit and the spin.
For fermions?
For fermions, yeah. So, for anything that has half integer spin.
So this whole Young tableau thing wouldn't quite work for bosons?
Works fine.
Yeah.
It's even easier. Yeah, because then, if this were spin ones and minus ones and zeros that I was putting in there, I wouldn't use zeros for that, I'd use the numbers. One and one bar probably, and then the zero that would fit in the box, right? Okay. Then I'm required to build the entire wave function to be symmetric. So my orbit's got to be like this if that one's like that.
You don't have to worry about conjugate, I guess.
No, But you have to go through all of the Young Tableau, because every one of them can make a symmetric state. It's the, when it comes to making antimatter, it becomes a bit of a bore. It doesn't work all the time. Okay, well, we'll answer more of that later on. But here's the thing that answers the question, what preserves these symmetry species? Suppose I have a symmetry species E2G, and it's got a nuclear spin of 5 or whatever. And then there's an A1G that somehow came up with a nuclear spin of 3, so it's hyperfine, was a triplet, and this one was a quintet, okay? Well, these things right here, these little splittings here, the hyperfine splittings, are really small. I mean, you know, compared to infrared frequencies, which are trillions of hertz or hundreds of trillions of hertz, okay? We're talking about kilohertz. That's pretty high even for some of these things. So the idea is that this guy here, and a spindrel vibration operator here, that might be, you know, a number that was, well, because this one's very small, still a small number. We're hoping maybe to get the perturbation denominator up, okay? Well, that's not going to happen, says Hertzberg. What's the probability that anything, any of these things are going to be within a fraction of a kilohertz of each other, so that this is close enough to zero to account for something that you can measure? Because this thing in the numerator is so damn close to zero, forget about it. That's what he's saying, right? These things are using hundreds of megahertz separations. Okay. So it's too darn big. All right? Because the nuclear moments are so very slight, it's actually his sort of wonderful way of saying it. Okay? But then we come along and say, way, this is no way, this is way. Okay? Because the levels of different species are forced together by angular wave localization or level clustering, or rarely by accidental degeneracy, that's, he never, he said maybe you might get something that would, where you have two or three levels crossing all at one point. And we do have that actually in some of our clusters. But most of the time we just have very small splitting. And they can be really tiny because they're governed by an exponential. Tunneling parameter is exponential. That sneak factor S is exponential. And out on the edges, you can see 10 to the minus 50 hertz, no problem. You have, you know, that thing sits there and resonates for centuries. You see. So even if the all of this is correct, this is going to wait for it. It's going to wait for it. It's going to happen. Okay. So the idea is then these things that we held so religiously are seriously mixed up. Not just a little bit. Seriously, completely wiped out as designations of the symmetry of the molecule. Okay, so that's what we want to see. So how's that wipe out? What's it, what form does it take? Okay. So let's go and do it with really low symmetry. Not so low. It's an infinite group that I'm talking about here. I'm talking about CO2 molecule. Okay? For example. Okay? So I've got say a carbon has no spin, I got an oxygen maybe that does have some spin, that would be a good example. And it's two oxygens and one carbon that's colored badly here. Black, is, I couldn't find a black ball there to do this. Anyway, let's look at the notation here for the first, the 3D orthogonal group, remember. L equals 0, L equals 1, L equals 2, that angular momentum of atomic sort is either called S or big S, or P and big P for 1, or D and big D for 2, and F and big F for 3. That's the atomic level. But here's the molecular level. They just Greekize it. This is sigma, or big sigma. This is little pi, or big pi. This is delta or big delta, and this is phi or big phi. Now, they run out of symbols very quickly because angular momentum in the molecular world, as you saw, goes up to 88, much higher than that if you want to heat it a little bit. So this Greek business is going to fall apart, but we can get started with it here. So we're going to be doing here some correlations, both at the bare level and at the activity level and at the product level that is needed to make the ABC transition theory that we're going to be talking about here. But in any case, this is a list of all of the representations of R3, or O3, actually. O3, we didn't bother putting the parity symbol onto those. Nuclear physicists always do that. Atomic physicists only when they have to. The 0 plus and 0 minus are two different representations associated with, and then it's a question of looking at the character table, which is about to be put there, for this group, which has, well, very obviously, three axis rotations by any angle whatsoever, alpha. Okay? A rotation by 180 degrees around any axis whatever. So there's a whole bunch of those things around any alpha, minus alpha, plus alpha, and a beta of 180 degrees. So when you flip the guy over, you got that guy. Then inversion, there's only one of those. Okay? It simply takes everything and puts it through the origin to the other side, balanced. And then a product of the rotation times I, rotation inversion. And then finally reflection. This is a reflection through a plane, any plane that goes that contains the axis of the molecule, any alpha. So that's a complete set of classes of operations for this lead group here, okay? And of course, every element in there is classed by itself, so this matches the situation. We're going to have an infinite number of irreducible representations to go with an infinite number of elements. But we're just going to look at the first few, okay? That's the trick here, okay? So the question is, you know, how far do you want to raise this quantum number here? That's going to be your quantum number. And we'll be using E1 when the quantum number is 1, okay? And then when I play 2, I'll put a little 2 here. So that's very similar notation we were using for the hexagonal symmetry. But it only had an E1 and an E2. But it had an E1G and an E1U and an E2G and an E2U if you did the full D6H. So D6H is enough to get you started seeing what all of these are. And then what we call A1, A2, B1, B2 have these names right here. Okay? And this one is A1G and A1U. That's A1 and A2. And then A2G and A2U, that's B1 and B2 for our hexagon, okay? And that's it for the one-dimensional representation. There's nothing more there. But this is the notation you'll find in literature for molecular. G and U, that makes sense. That's the 1 or minus 1 for inversion. G and U, 1 and minus 1 for inversion. So inversion is determining the EU and the EG. The plus and the plus, okay, that's a little harder because what you do is you take a product with the inversion and this number right here, actually the reflection is probably the best way to say that for that one. I take it back, it's not so hard. The plus plus goes with this plus 1 and that plus 1. The minus minus goes with that minus and that minus. After that, it's all zero for there. So we take over and everything's E from here on down. Okay? So we have an E1 that corresponds to cosine of alpha with a 1 coefficient. And it can be either G or U, depending on whether a minus is going to be put on the cosines. And then when it comes to 2, there's your delta You see, this is pi. Remember, pi is p, delta is d. Okay, pretty simple. Now, most molecular physicists for a long time only did diatomic molecules, so this is the end of the course for them. Most of our physicists said, I cannot stand to work with an atom that has more than one nucleus. That means you can't do molecular physics. Yeah. That's why Americans, there are hardly any molecular physicists in America. Pretty stupid, huh? And Feynman was kind of that way. He didn't think, when I showed him some of this molecular stuff, he just went crazy. He wouldn't want to go over there. He'd made a decision a long time ago. Probably went to a molecular meeting and figured, these guys are stupid. Because they just sat there and they did these polynomial expansions, and they were working on 27th coefficient of some expansion, saying, hey, this improved my 300th level here by a factor of 14%. It was more like going to a stockholders meeting where you don't own the stock. Okay, so here is the correlation table between O3 and O2, okay? 0 plus goes to sigma plus G. The 0 minus state goes to sigma minus U, okay? And then 1 plus, it splits into sigma minus U and then a pi G. Both of them G if it's plus. Both of them U if it's minus. And then 2, you can guess that it's going to split into deltas, okay? But it'll also be making some pi's along the way, and so on. So pretty soon you have quite a few 1's here as you go down into the S, which are the phi states. And then below that, we're kind of running out of Greek letters there. Okay, so once you have the correlation table, you can start playing games. And now, what we're going to discuss here, and we're going to sort of rush through this, but I just wanted you to see, here are the states that you would have if you had just a scalar electron, that is, just a nice little sigma state that didn't have any angular momentum, but you did have rotor motion, okay? And let's suppose somehow this thing had some wings on it so that I could get some of those n values, those k values, up above zero, all right? Now, this won't happen with CO2. I need a molecule that's got some wings on it in order to get any states like this. So I would have to, say, pull up some ozone or something like that, some molecule, or just benzene. I could pull up benzene, but then I've got to fiddle around with all the modes that it has and somehow come up with a thing that wasn't vibrating and it would look like this. So this is very strictly a toy molecule. But then we're going to ask to put on board it a pi electron that has some angular momentum. And that's the activity that we're going to put on board this molecule. And if we put it on there right, we get a nice set of levels that come out and make some sense out of each other. And we get to see some weird kind of doublets. They're called lambda doublets, and I want to give you some feeling for what those things are. So this is something that's in that first paper I wrote on molecular physics. It came out, and I managed to squeeze it into Reviews of Modern Physics, which is, a little cheeky, to say the least. but we did it. I don't think we could pull something like that off these days. But anyway, we're going to have these types of symmetry levels: activity, vibration, mode, like electronic. Okay. Bare rotor. That's just rotations associated with whatever nuclear spin will allow the internal thing, the heart of the molecule, so to speak. And then, when we put these two together, we make a coupled or constriction. Coupled, if it's that weak coupling we talked about yesterday, or constriction, BOA constriction, Born-Oppenheimer approximate constriction. A snake, a boa, that, you've ever seen a ball get its prey, it sits there and sort of looks at it, and then all of a sudden it goes and wraps it up. So that's what we're talking about. We're talking about an electron wave that's wrapped up the molecule and is riding with it perfectly. Mm-hmm. Okay? Burmese python can do this to a deer. You know, Burmese, it's only about this big, but it can a deer, and it just waits until it's dead and then starts putting itself around the deer, swallowing it. And then it just sits there. Slowly the lump goes down over days. If you really wanted to do something interesting, this is dull compared to what happens in the natural world. But it's also something we can calculate, so we maintain our... Anyway, let's look at the correlation table backwards, okay? If I've got a sigma G state, then the only angular momentum states that are allowing, that I'm allowed to, angular momentum parity, is 0 plus, 2 plus, I skip all of those, and then down there somewhere is a 4 plus, that would be the next one, and so on. So this is all I'm going to get if I have, if I'm stuck with a bare rotor that is symmetric. So I have a symmetric wave function for these two things off-center, the off-center guys. If it's a symmetric wave function, then that's what I've got. And I better have spin zero inside those nuclei, or I'm not going to be able to pull this off. I won't be able to do that. Okay, so this is an ortho species. It would be done by with oxygens that had no spin. Okay? So that's really the simplest molecule eigen-solution model. Okay? These are all excluded. No sigma plus correlation. That's all we're allowed. Okay? Now, let's suppose it's fermion. That's very thin. Let's say H2. What can I do with H2? Okay? Well, what I can do is I can put the, this isn't H2, so this is C12, C13, has no symmetry. If I have no symmetry, then I'm not very, very restricted. I can get my 0 plus out, okay, I can get my 1 minus out, I can get my 2 plus out, but that's what I have to use. I'm talking about sigmas here, so I'm kind of stuck using either that guy or that guy. You see, I can have sigma G and sigma U now, okay? And that's kind of it. I'm either going to have an even angular momentum, okay, with a plus sign on it, or I'm going to have an odd one with a minus sign for the spin, so that the two, they're allowed to go together here. There's no Fermi boson thing, because those are different kinds of nuclei. One's boson, the other's fermion, right? But now, if it's two of these, whoo, what we got, okay? Well, there's one possibility. This is where I have a symmetric orbit like I did in the very first example, but then I absolutely have to have an anti-symmetric spin. So I have to have a spin singlet. Okay, that's definitely what I've got to have. Whereas, if I make my orbit anti-symmetric, that is, have an odd value of angular momentum, okay, then I get to have a symmetric spin, but symmetric spin makes a triplet. Okay? Now, this situation is called a member of the para species. This one is called a member of the ortho species. How do you remember it? Ortho always has more spin states, because ortho is forcing the spatial wave function to be anti-symmetric. Now, this is true for fermions only, but whatever gives you the more spin states, and this works for fermions and bosons, is, as far as I can tell, always turns out to be ortho. Okay, orthodox is the majority, right? Paradox is minorities, scary minority, right? Well, comfortable majority is orthodox, right? So whatever has the most population of spin states That's going to get called ortho in this business. Okay, so this was excluded from the paras. This is excluded from the orthos. I can't have a 0 plus and a 2 plus, but I can have a 1 minus and a 3 minus, because that will make me the symmetry of the spin that I need to go with the orbit.
This is, I do it that. This is pretty fast.
What's that?
This is very fast. But for each of the different types of these bare rotors, like how are you picking out the... So from the character table, you can tell from the different L value what kind of projected modes you're going to have based on the 0 plus or minus. And so by the based on the symmetry of the diagrams on the top, you can pick out which modes should go with that model of molecule. Is that right?
Yeah. We're in a vacuum, so our overall symmetry is going to be determined by R3. Okay. And then R3 correlates, that's what this correlation table is, with all those representations of the O2. This is these are the O2 representations. Okay. Now, we're going along with Hertzberg at this point, saying what we're really interested in is just one of these species at a time. You see, because he's claiming, you know, you can set up one of those species and it's just going to sit there. It's going to be there'll be the orthochemical and there'll be the parachemical, but they're not going to mix. They're not going to interplay with each other. So that is, if I created an orthohydrogen, which would be this. And that would work, you see, because I have hydrogen, right? And it's got a spin a half, okay? And I produce orthohydrogen. I don't have a 0 plus level. I do have this one. That's my ground state. I can't go below that. This is excluded by Fermi-Pauli exclusion. And I can't have a 2 plus either. I can have a 3 minus. And I can have a 5 minus. And that's it. That's what hydrogen, liquid hydrogen sitting in a barrel. Liquid hydrogen sitting in an iron barrel will blow up because of this. How does that happen? It was a big surprise. Happened right in the middle of World War I. They were using the hydrogen for dirigibles. Okay. It's got a lot of lifting power. Helium's terrible compared to hydrogen. Wow, it really screws on hydrogen, right? But they started an iron tank. And Uhlenbeck is credited with figuring out what happened. They thought it was terrorists, what they call that, saboteurs. Blew up this hydrogen, blew up the entire blimp hangar, everything. It's all just splattered all over the place. A lot of people died. It just sat there. And the reason what happened was, you bring it in, it's in para state, okay? But with the iron case, every time the hydrogen comes near iron, it's a little magnetism, now it can mix the species. So it goes down here. It puts a little bit of energy into the hydrogen. Then that happens days, weeks, right? It keeps going. Every time the hydrogen gets the iron, it's a good chance it's going to go down. Put some more heat out, right? Pretty soon it started to boil. Hydrogen has above the boil temperature. The boil temperature is where the gas will actually get hotter on expansion instead of getting cooler when you expand it. If you're above the boil temperature, this got above the boil temperature. That's not the boiling temperature, there's a few degrees. And as soon as it did that, all hell broke. Finally got up to combustion temperature, blew up. And the whole liquid caught fire and then blew up. So it's a major deal with these two levels. Really important. I'm glad you asked that question, because I completely forgot about that little incidental thing that Uhlenbeck figured out.
From the species mixing that...
The iron cost.
Hertzberg denied or didn't.
He's talking about in the molecule by itself. You see. And if I didn't have an iron thing, it won't do it. You put it in something that doesn't have any magnetic materials, you're good to go. So it's not breaking Hertzberg rule. Hertzberg rule applies only to the molecule by itself. It's just sitting or rotating, and can it, bust a species or not? And he's claiming not. But we're saying no. It can be an inside job too, because of clustering.
Just beer and smoke.
Bring those guys together. It's a good chance they will form completely new species, a new kind of species, mixture of the old species. Okay. Now, here's what happens when you put some activity on. Say you have an electron in a sigma U plus state, or we start out having a scalar situation, sigma G activity. That's what we were talking about just a little bit here, but each of these can be excited, and this one doesn't have any symmetry requirements, so you get a lot more levels and a lot more transitions for something like that than these symmetry guys. These symmetry guys, you know, do so much less than these guys, but that makes for easy spectroscopy. The spectroscopy with fewer levels is going to be done quicker than more levels with more complexity. So what we are looking at here is the constriction here, where I take the A cross B to figure out what I should be looking at on this correlation table here, okay? And when I put a sigma U plus with a sigma G plus, I get a sigma U plus. That's a scalar, okay? So I look down a sigma plus U column right here to see what I can have, and the first thing I can have here is a 1 minus, and then a 3 minus. So that's a pretty simple case of activity, but just to give you a feeling for how you play these games with the B and the Pauli or Bose exclusion principle. What if you put a pi U in, and the pi U and the sigma plus U are two partners in this correlation, a table for angular momentum, vector angular momentum, the axial vector angular momentum, okay, which has a sigma plus U and a pi U splitting out from it. So that's what we're going to be playing with on this diagram here. But you still play the same game, okay? Go with your sigma plus U, sigma plus G, that is attained by taking your sigma plus G and your sigma plus U here and multiplying it by the activity. And when you do this up here, you get this pi U and pi G. And then you go over to the correlation table and look up pi U and pi G and see what angular momentum levels you're going to get. 1 plus, 2 plus, 3 plus. Okay, that's fine. That's this guy right there. And then the other one is doing it with the minuses. Okay, this one right here. And then this one right here is 2 minus. And then 3 minus. Okay, so that's that stack right there. And there they are, unless they're in some kind of weird iron cage, they're going to be different chemicals. This is going to be its thing, and this is going to stay this one, according to Hertzberg. Okay? And for the most part, he's right. These guys aren't going to cluster. Okay? It's when you've got the big molecules that you're going to see some funny business. Alright. Now, what's going on here? This activity that I put on there is a little dumbbell consisting of an electronic orbital, a p orbital, plus and minus phase, okay? And I can put it on there so that it nicely rotates or is perpendicular to the axis of the molecule. Or I can put it right on the axis of the molecule, okay? Now the idea is that the sigma U, sigma pi U waves will actually start mixing a little bit there, because what's going to happen is this thing rotates. If you have a situation like this and the J is like that, this thing's spinning around. This thing's got to keep up with the molecule, okay, to stay, perpendicular to it. And it's obviously going to have a little bit of mixing with the one that's lined up with the molecule. So any of the waves that are there are going to, you know, slip into each other. So there's going to be some mixing between this guy right here and this guy right here. And you're going to see that in the Hamiltonian as a thing that perturbs both of them in a hyperbolic way, because it's a two-state system we're playing with here. So that's the thing here. That's the difference between the a pi u minus and the a pi u plus parallel to j, this one perpendicular to j, they're going to mix. But the one that's right already, that's perpendicular to both of these and the angular momentum, not so much. It's just going to go right on through. So that's what the lambda doubling story. And this is just taken right out of the reviews of modern physics. And there's a whole set of levels when I let everything go. But here's the sigma state where the electron is tied to the axis and stays there with a S state, and then somebody excites it so it has angular momentum 1 and puts a state perpendicular to the thing this way and perpendicular to the thing that way. And let's see if there's anything else. That's pi plus and pi minus. And corresponds to angular momentum 1 plus. And then this guy gets into the act, it'll be part of that. That corresponds to a 1 minus. These two don't talk to each other, but they do talk this way. The 1 minus talks to this 1 minus down here. And that's what causes the levels to shift. And basically what you're doing is you're the lambda doubling here between the pi minus and the pi plus is due to one of them getting shoved up and that slipping occurring on. Pi minus it isn't affected by that. This is a sigma plus here. There are two states up here. Anyway, the full description of this thing, you know, requires a good day of fooling around and looking at the both the levels of other states as well. But we need to carry on here and look at we're going to look at dipole allowed transitions for sure, but this is a picture that we looked at, I think, before, showing the P and the R branches with the B values the same. If the B values are different, it gets a little complicated. You form what are called band heads as the parabola sort of tips over and these guys start to cross to make levels that look like, or make spectra that looks like that. This will happen when excited states have different inertia than the ground state. So that's something to be aware of. But we're not going to go that far. We're going to do just a central Q branch here just to look at what happens if I have a rhombic species sigma G plus and then sigma U plus. Now the idea is that Hertzberg rules are okay. Hertzberg's rule is going to say that I cannot cross this guy with this guy. That's forbidden. Okay? This guy over here, however, we'll talk to that one. And they're both species, you see, so they can interchange. In optical transition, okay, the kind of thing that will make spectra like this. But you see, you're going to miss the Q branch. There won't be any Q branch. So that's something you can look at a spectra and tell a lot about a molecule by just looking, see if the Q branch is there or not. Because there's no way I can get a transition right there, or there, or there, or everywhere, anywhere that they're crossing. Because these things have the wrong Rowe-Brownian symmetry. Belong to different species or different chemicals. And even when you've got one of them in the pi state, same thing. Now you could make a Q branch, but you do it by having those two talk to each other. This one and one just like it here, okay? And this can talk to that and that, so forth. But nobody here can talk to anybody in this area. So here's where that rovibronic diagram is really helpful. You're putting a bottle that has both species in it. You're going to get spectra from both of them, but you can sort it. You can sort the ones that are coming from this species from the ones that are coming from this species. And that's, I think, a very useful thing. Now, let's get busy on the tableaus. We don't have all that much time, and we only need a year, so we need a whole course on these guys, really. But I can give you a feeling for what it does, and also a few formulas that you can use right away. I won't derive the formulas. That's really tricky. And that's what this field really needs, is somebody to find a good way to derive the formulas that I'm going to be showing you here. In any case, this is from the old Reviews of Modern Physics paper, and I've added this here just to make it clearer. This is A1 for S2. This is A2 for S2. S2, C2, synonymous as far as group structure. But the thing you should realize is that cycle notation, like this, or this is a bicycle, this is a couple of unicycles, okay? This is no permutation, this is a permutation of 1 and 2, cycle back and forth between 1 and 2. That's what C2 really is when you're thinking about reflection operators, say, or rotation by 180 degrees. That was our first group, right? Well, that's our first Young tableau set, okay? The idea is there are two partitions of the numbers 1 and 2. One of them is 1 and 2 on separate columns. The other one is 1 and 2 in the same column, okay? Well, that one represents the anti-symmetric case, and this one represents the symmetric case. Now, is this going to work for 3? You see, that's one of the things that a Colorado physicist, and I'm trying to think of his name, Gamow, I think it was, wrote a book called 1-2-Infinity. It says, if you can figure out 3, you can figure out infinity. And that's the case that we're going to have here. If you figure out what happens at 3, you're golden. You're done.
Induction.
Now, 3 has a partition in which all 3 numbers are in different columns. In the column, I mean, different boxes on the x-axis. Okay. So this is the partition for the representation. This is the partition for that class of 1. Then if you put all the numbers in one column, okay, like that, that's the partition. I would call that 3. Okay, all 3 in the same column. That's corresponding to this class right here. Okay. That's the class of 120 degree rotations, forwards or backwards. And that's the way you read these things. Particle 1 goes to where particle 2 was, particle 2 goes where particle 3 was, and particle 3 goes, you have to go back to the beginning here and read the 1. Okay. So that's a full 3 cycle. But this is a bicycle plus a unicycle. This is 2 plus 1. 2 plus 1. Now, what you do then is you fill the boxes with numbers in such a way that they increase to the right and down. This time, it's the English that win. It's not Hebrew. English, you read this way and then down, right? So this thing has to increase as you go this way and increase as you go down. And then no other no other set of numbers is allowed. You start with 1, that's what we had was S1. You take the 1-2 and the 1-2 and you put a 3 on it in such a way as you always fit them in a corner. You have to fit them, it's like boxes in a corner of a room, and you lay them out so that the 1 is always in the corner, and then the others can take turns being here or here. So that gives me a representation that's going to have two dimensions. So I already know the characters by looking at that young tableau. And I know that these guys are one because I can't arrange that any other way. You believe that? I've got a bridge for you. But it's true. I mean, it's just magic. And this is stuff that Alfred Young discovered, pretty much. Although his boxes, it's hard to critique something that's really so brilliant. It's just amazing. Okay, so we take this guy right here, and we can put a box on the end, the fourth box, or we could put it right there. That's this one, okay? And then I go to this one, I can take a box, number four, and put it right there. There it is, right at the very bottom there, okay? Just put the fourth box right where it is, okay? And then I could put a box at the very bottom. That's this one. We've just gotten A1, A2, and part of, the last part of, T1. Okay, on to the next one, right? I take this tableau right here. The first thing I do is put my fourth box at the very right and top. That's this one, okay? We've already done the box on this one. It's this one, so this is the next one that I get for T2. Okay. And then I can stick a box right in the crotch there, okay? That's this guy, okay? And then the very last thing was to stick it on the bottom, okay? Mm-hmm. I've got two of those cases. There's one right there, and then I can stick it on the bottom of that one and just get the rest of the thing. And then I got to stick a box there, okay, and a box there. And that's the last of the T2. Isn't that amazing? You know how hard we work to get these numbers, right? Had to solve that fifth degree equation, right? And then unsort it, right? That was not trivial. Okay. Now, I haven't given you the formulas yet for these numbers here, but they exist and they're very simple based on the tableau. Links and things. Okay? Now, 5 is next. Okay, permutation 5. The geometrical connection there is with icosahedral. A5 is the icosahedral group. A5 is half of the S5. Now, where is A4 while we're on that? The set of all even permutations. Okay? This and this are even permutations. These two are odd. So we're talking about just this, and this class, okay? And if you recall, that consisted of two complex representations and one of these. That was the T group. That's A4. A5 is the icosahedral group, and then the actual S5 is the completion of the icosahedral group to a full permutation group. Okay, so that's kind of all I'm going to say right at the moment about the tableaus, except to show some formulas that go with them. Now, this is the character table, of course, in its normal form for TD, the tetrahedral group. There really are talking about permutations of four things of a methane-like molecule. So that, the methane-like XY4 is perfect for this. This is CF4 that we have spectra for that fits that so nicely. And then there's a correlation between O3 and TD. It's just a little bit different in certain parity ways from the correlation with the octahedral group, which is isomorphic to TD, but there are differences. And instead of calling the three-dimensional representations T1 and T2, you'll see them always being using F1 and F2. Don't have no reason why they do that, but maybe it's a good thing so that you know that what you're talking about right away. But here's a correlation that isn't trivial at all. When you're talking about SF6, you're talking about permutations of six things. Now, most of those permutations never get to happen. It's just not like an SF6 molecule to do that. These are really strongly bound fluorines to the sulfur. And they're stuck in a deep well, and they do not do that. And to do that, it's much easier just to do that. But then you permeate all the other guys, right? If you want to permeate four things, no problem. There's a nice four cycle, right? Except you do it in step, deep, 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 like that. Or three, right? You can go on three there, go 120. 240 and back again on the 111 axis. What we're doing here is treating the entire octahedral symmetry, that's A1G, A2G, EG through T1U, as a local symmetry. That's hair pulling, right? What you're saying is, at one point, these three fullerenes were floating around in the universe, and somehow, through some sort of dating agency, they got together in a molecule like this. And when they got together, they're stuck in those positions. But there are six factorial different positions that could have been achieved when they came together. 6 factorial 720 is a lot bigger than 48, which is the number of arrangements that you're allowed to do with the octahedral group OH, and that's what we're looking at there. So here we are doing a correlation between the higher symmetry, which has for fermions these tableaus as the orbital denoters. And for bosons, if I have, instead of fluorine, I have oxygen or something like that that has no spin, the isotope that has no spin, I would be doing these guys right here for the orbit, and I would be using the same thing for their spins. Here, if it's a fermion, and I use that tableau, I've got to use this tableau for the spins. If I use this tableau here, I've got to use this tableau for the spins, and so on. You see, so the fermions are, you know, sort of more cosmopolitan or something. They're making more use of the shapes. You see, and of course I come down here. Here I'm using this guy for the spins and this guy for the orbit, but there's another state where this guy, who's right here, is being used for the orbit, and that means this one has to be used for the spins. It takes a heck of a lot of spin to make that tableau. Because spin a half is out for any of these guys that has more than two rows. That's out. I can't put spin up, spin down, and then what do I put that's different from spin up and spin down? I'm stuck. That's not going to show up in a spin a half molecule. This will show up, but this one won't show up, nor will this one, nor will this one, nor will this one, nor will this one, nor will that one.
So see? You could use the fourth one for a spin three halves molecule.
Then you're in good shape. You can go all the way through this guy right here, but you can't use this guy. See, you need this guy right here with all six down there, five halves, right? You got to have five halves spin in order to use all of these tableaus.
What kind of molecule has five halves?
What nuclei has five halves?
could be bigger and better than that. So they're a lucky ball.
That's a good question. Grab the what I call the most frightening book in this room. It's blue and white, above the clock and to the left. There you go.
Okay.
This is the most frightening book in the universe of our culture. Table of Isotopes. Let's just open it up, random page.
Yeah.
Okay, there's the energy levels for dysprosium. Let's go toward the beginning where they're not so horrendous. What it's doing right here is showing you tin and cesium transitions between all of their nuclear levels, all of the nucleons in there orbiting and doing all kinds of stuff with their spins. And these are things that have been detected in experiments that involve mostly quadrupole transitions. There are a few giant resonances, they're called dipole giant resonances. But this is the thing. And then the question is, what is the spin that you're talking about? And that's always written here. And here's an 11 halves minus. That's the ground state of tin 51 125. So I just opened up something that had even more spin than we need to make use of all of those tableaus. I don't think I have a molecule with six tins. That probably won't fly. Okay. Now, why is this the most dangerous thing? Because every one of those transitions is gamma rays. So if you make a laser out of these things, it's a death ray. So eventually, physicists are going to kill themselves. What do we do with that? So watch out. Don't let Trump remake.
That's the annoyance of your tutor.
Or any of the other authoritarians that are slowly taking over places like Turkey. Okay. Now, I think since we're over time, we can use the final period, which should probably be next week, when you guys are through with whatever it is that you have to be through with, like the problems, or at least close to through. We'll have a lecture at a convenient time, and we can set that by email.